Welcome again. It's great to see all of you. Many of you know we've been preaching through this sermon series about Dove International's foundational values. And many of you know that we're part of a church family called Dove International. If you check out the map on the side wall, you can see where all the churches in our church family are around the world. The little dots are one church, the big dots are 10 churches. And we've got like over 500 churches worldwide, and we're growing really rapidly in Africa and India, some of those places. But new churches are being planted in the USA too. And it's exciting to see what God is doing and where God is at work. So these values, these 12 values that we've been talking about for quite some time, are the solid basic foundational things that we all believe together as a church family. I just want to review where we've been so far. We're on number 8 today. Number 1, Dove value number 1, is knowing God the Father through His Son Jesus Christ and living by His Word is the foundation of life. So that's one and probably most important. Number 2, it is essential for every believer to be baptized with the Holy Spirit and be completely dependent on Him. Number 3, the Great Commission will be completed through prayer, evangelism, discipleship, and church planting. Number 4, we deeply value the sacred covenant of marriage and the importance of training our children to know Christ. Number 5, we are committed to spiritual families, spiritual parenting, and intergenerational connections. Number 6, spiritual multiplication and reproduction must extend to every sphere of kingdom life and ministry. Number 7, relationships are essential in building God's kingdom. And now finally, number 8, where we are today. Every Christian is both a priest and a minister. How would you like to be a priest? My first thought when I hear the word priest relates more probably to the Catholic Church, if I'm going to be honest, and priests that I know in that church, and some are good friends of mine. But what does it mean? I don't understand. I'm sure many of you have question marks too in your mind. What does it mean that every Christian ought to be a priest? And so I'm calling this strange, really strange title for this morning, How to Be a Priest in 2018. Oh, yeah. And so if you want an instruction manual this morning on how to be a priest, here we go. You're going to learn how to be a priest this morning. And so to be a priest, we have to understand what or who a priest was back in Bible times, in the times of the Old Testament. Probably one of the most significant verses that I have for you, and perhaps you've heard this verse quoted many times in churches, is from Ezekiel 22. If you have your Bible along, I encourage you to turn to Ezekiel 22 and verse 30. I'm going to put it up on the screen as well. It says, I look for someone, a man among them, who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land so I would not have to destroy it, but I found no one. And so this, to many of you, maybe this verse brings up even more questions, like stand in the gap. What exactly does that mean? What gap? Standing in the gap. And we believe that God's word teaches that there is a gap, there is a space between people and God. Because back in Genesis, when God created the earth, He said it was very good. Genesis 1. And there was no divide between God and people on earth at that time. But we know the story of Genesis, where Adam and Eve disobeyed God, sin came into the world, and sin creates this gap between people on one side and God on the other, and there's this gap between God and humanity, and that includes us, all the way down through, cutting off future generations off from God's best for their lives. So standing in the gap often refers to either praying or interceding or intervening on behalf of someone else. And so that was the job of the Old Testament priest. So we're going to have 3 points here this morning. First is the job and responsibilities of the priest in the Old Testament. And I know this is ancient history, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it because some of you don't like history. The Old Testament priest was one who interceded. He stood in the gap. He intervened for the people before God. They stood in the gap. The Old Testament priests served God and the Israelites as they were wandering in the desert on their way to the promised land. It was a portable tent. They didn't have a temple because they had to pick up and move. They had to pack up their tents and go. So their place of worship was this tent of meeting that they would set up and tear down and go off to the next place where God told them to go. So that was like a tabernacle, tent of meeting. And then they got to the promised land, and eventually they built a temple, a place to go and worship God. It was a permanent building where they could go and meet with God. And so we see that God established people who were called priests, because even though God is we call God our Father, he is still an awesome and holy person. His holiness was such he couldn't just be lightly approached by ordinary men and women. So God ordained people called. People called priests. Remember what Cindy said. Give them grace. People called priests who would come before the people on one hand and God on the other hand. So the priests and the Levites assumed this awesome and grave task of approaching God on behalf of the people. Their most important job was one day out of the year. This was one holy day from which we get our word holiday, holy day, holiday. Now you learned something this morning where the word holiday comes from. It was from holy day. The one holy day of the year was the Day of Atonement. It was the most important day of the Jewish religious calendar. And scriptures describe it this way. That's a good example of what the priest looked like in Old Testament times. That's a good example of what that tent of meeting looked like back in Old Testament times. As they moved from place to place, they set it up, they tear it down as they were going. And sort of another artist's idea of what the tabernacle looked like. So Leviticus 16 says, the priest, he will then slaughter the goat for the sin offering for the people and take its blood behind the curtain and do with it as he did with the bull's blood. He shall sprinkle it on the atonement cover and in front of it. And in this way, he will make atonement for the most holy place because of the uncleanness and rebellion of the Israelites, whatever their sins have been. And Hebrews 9, after this was set up, the priests went about their duties in the large tent. Only the high priest entered the smaller inside tent, and then only once a year, offering a blood sacrifice for his own sins and the people's accumulated sins. So each priest had to carefully and fully obey what God said. First, he sacrificed an animal for the forgiveness of his own sins, and then he sacrificed another animal as a sin offering for the whole nation of Israel. Now, I don't know if you've ever thought about how different worship in Old Testament time must have been to the way we worship here today. Because, you know, usually in church services here in America, we try to have a church building that's relatively quiet and that smells good and that is clean. But back in those times, you went to worship God on those days. It was a noisy thing because people were bringing their animals to be sacrificed, and it was a smoky thing because they were burning sacrifices there on the altar. So there was noise and there was smoke, and they were actually slaughtering animals right there on the spot as sacrifices. So there was blood everywhere. So, you know, we come here and it's a nice, clean, quiet place. But you went to worship back then. It was just this noisy, smoky, bloody mess. And it's quite a lot different than we worship here today. And so there were consequences also for priests who did not serve God correctly. And one example comes from Leviticus chapter 10. These were Aaron was the first priest, he was the first high priest, and his sons, Nadab and Abihu, the Bible says, took their censers and put hot coals in them and offered strange fire to God, something God had not commanded. Fire blazed out from God and consumed them, and they died in God's presence. So not only was it a noisy, smoky, bloody place, but it was a place, if you didn't do things right, you'd be knocked down dead right there on the spot. Now, the Bible isn't really clear what this means, strange fire, but the sons of Aaron clearly disobeyed God in some way. They treated holy things in a casual way and a careless way. And so for the priest back then, you risked your life serving a holy God. The priest laid down his life before God on behalf of the whole nation of Israel and risked being struck down dead. Now, legend has it, we're really not sure if this is true or not, but legend has it that the high priest, when he went back into that holiest of holies back in the temple or tabernacle, that they would tie a rope to his ankle in case he got struck down dead while he was back there, that the guys who were out there could haul him out without having to go back out. Not sure if it's completely true, but it does line up with hey, you were risking your life and you could be struck down dead as a priest if you didn't do things the way God said. You know, I wonder how differently we would act in Sunday service. If we knew, we might be struck down dead if we came to Sunday service to preach or to teach or to worship or to serve with something that was unholy in our lives. And we knew we were risking the fire of God burning us up right there on the spot. You know, what's that black spot on the floor over there? That's where Fred was last Sunday, but he's not there anymore. You know? I think we would probably act a little bit differently. We would take God and his word a little bit seriously. It does illustrate, I think, how seriously we should view any kind of sin in our lives. It illustrates how seriously we should view any kind of disobedience in our lives, because sin is a life or death matter. And so to review, one of the jobs of the Old Testament priest was to intervene, to intercede for the sins of the people before God every year. Secondly, we get to the New Testament and we find that there's no longer a need for these Old Testament priests. Everything changes with the life and death of Jesus. And we find that instead of generations and generations of priests who would sacrifice animals and go into that tabernacle to offer that blood for the sin of the people, now we have one priest who's done it, and we don't need another one. Hebrews 9 says, when the Messiah, that is Jesus, arrived, the high priest of the superior things of this new covenant, he bypassed the old tent and its trappings in this created world and went straight into heaven's tent, the true holy place, once and for all. He also bypassed the sacrifices consisting of goat and calf blood, instead using his own blood as the price to set us free once and for all. So God himself stood in the gap, sending his son Jesus in human form to live as a man, to die for our sins, to rise from the dead, so we could be restored, each one of us, into a personal relationship with God. So in Jesus' death on the cross, he acts as the priest, standing in the gap, intervening between God and man. But Jesus acted not only as the priest, he acted as the goat or the animal who was sacrificed, whose blood was necessary for the forgiveness of sins. So Jesus was both the priest and the sacrificial animal at the same time. Hebrews 9:15, through the Spirit, Christ offered himself as an unblemished sacrifice, freeing us from all those dead-end efforts to make ourselves respectable so that we can live all out for God. And not only did Jesus act as priest in the past, but we read scripture in Romans chapter 8 and verse 34 tells us what Jesus is doing for us right now in heaven. If you've seen your Bibles, Romans chapter 8 and verse 34, it says, who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Did you get that? Jesus is at the throne of God today, right now, praying and interceding for each of you by name. He's praying for you. He's interceding for you at the throne of God right now. So Jesus' work didn't just finish at the cross, but Jesus continues to work on our behalf. So to review, instead of having a priest sacrifice animals for our sin, we have one great final high priest, Jesus himself. Animal sacrifices no longer necessary. Jesus was both the priest and the sacrificial animal whose blood was shed. So finally, number three, every believer is a priest too. What does that mean? 1 Peter chapter 2. You are the ones chosen by God, chosen for the high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people, God's instruments to do his work and speak out for him, to tell others of the night and day difference he made for you. This is the Message translation. From nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. It's the concept of all Christians belonging to a priesthood, that each one of us is a priest. We're chosen. We're chosen to be what? A holy people. We're chosen to be God's instruments. We are chosen to speak out on behalf of God. I believe this means that we, all Christians, are called to be priests to the whole world at large. One writer says that Christians are called to be priests representing all mankind before God, and God before all mankind. Now that sounds like a gigantic task. Sounds like an impossible task to stand in the gap for the whole world. So let's drill it down a little bit for us here in Elm on June 3rd, 2018. Because at Newport Church, we've said that we feel God has called us to minister to Northern Lancaster County. That's our target audience. So people from other areas are welcome too. So if you're from Lebanon County, but our primary target is Northern Lancaster County. And since John 3:16, God so loved the world, we could fill in. We know that God so loved Northern Lancaster County, right? We know that God gave his son for each of our towns and each of our communities. And part of our job description then should be to act as priests and ministers to the place that God has planted you on behalf of our region. Ministers and priests on behalf of our region. That means intervening. That means interceding. That means standing in the gap for our community, giving your life for our community. Perhaps that means developing a new small group, like you're driving down the road and you see a place or God put something in your mind and you say, yeah, it would be so cool if there were a small group meeting in that Starbucks. Or it'd be so cool if there were a new small group meeting in that park. Or it'd be so exciting to have a small group meeting at that soccer field. So I believe that God wants to touch our communities with lots of new small groups that he's going to be creatively pouring into your mind and into your thoughts, into your spirit. Another way we can be priests and ministers on behalf of our region is I want to advertise for our prayer walk in our community on Sunday, July 8th. You already heard me talk about this. But I believe that we have an opportunity to intervene and intercede for our community on that day. So what is prayer walking all about? Well, first of all, let me give a disclaimer that prayer walking is not talked about in the Bible. You can search your Bible and you won't find Jesus commanding his followers to prayer walk. But if you put two and two together, walking was a primary method of transportation in Bible times. And we're told to pray without ceasing. So I suggest to you that early Christians both walked and prayed a lot at the same time. So how do you prayer walk? What does that mean? Well, one way is Jeremiah 29 and verse 7 is to pray scripture, seek the welfare of the city where I've sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf. So speak blessing, speak scripture over Lititz, over Mannheim, over Mount Joy, over Elizabethtown, over Ephrata, over East Petersburg, over Landisville. Speak scripture over your community. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Proverbs 14. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. So, as you're prayer walking, pray against sin and poverty and injustice. Pray for revival. Pray for holiness. Pray for prosperity. Pray for justice. Bless the body of Christ in your community. Pray against church competitions and comparison. Pray for every church that you go by. I encourage you, as you're driving on the road each day, if you drive by a church, pray blessing on that church. I don't care what kind of church it is, but pray blessing on that church. If it's a church that believes in Jesus, then pray that the pastors will be encouraged and strengthened. Pray for revival in that church. Pray for the passion and the fire of God to fill that church. Pray that people will be saved in that church. And pray that that church will be blessed. We don't see ourselves as competitors among churches, but we see ourselves as all part of one body and all part of one army, all units in the same army working and serving together. So don't go by a church and say, oh, that church is so small, it's probably going to close. Oh, too bad. No, pray blessing on them. Right. And you see a church that's growing and expanding and huge and building on, then bless them and say, that's great, that's awesome. Let them grow, let them prosper, let them flourish. Because you know what? Statistics say that only about 25% of Lancaster County is church. So that means we all, churches, have 75% of the county to reach. So we've got a lot of work to do. All the churches have a lot of work to do. So we want to stand together and bless each other and not compare and not compete. Pray for the churches to be filled with light. Pray for them to be filled with Holy Spirit power. Pray for the lost to come to salvation there. Pray for the pastors to be energized and full of vision. Confess the sin of your community before God and ask for his forgiveness on behalf of your community. There are great leaders in the Bible, Daniel, Nehemiah, Ezra, who confessed the sin of their nation before God. Not things that they've done personally, but the sin of their people. And so if you live in a locality, you can confess the sin of that locality before God and ask for his forgiveness for your location, for your region. Pray in obedience to the Spirit. This is all about prayer work. Pray in obedience to the Spirit. Ask God to show you what he sees. And as you're prayer walking, ask God, what do you see here in this community, and how do you want us to pray? And believe me, I, as our small group has prayer walked in Mannheim and Lititz, and I believe that as we prayer walked, I believe that we saw things that we never saw before as we were prayer walking. First of all, walking is slower than driving. So it's good to take your time and look around and see things and say, God, how and where do you want us to pray? Ask God to open your eyes to see things you never saw before. What are the sights? What are the sounds? What are the smells that you encounter? What are the signs? What are the posters? What are the graffiti? What are the trash? What do you see in the town that you're walking through? What buildings, what churches, what businesses, what banks, what city halls, what schools, what police stations? And how can you pray for the leaders in your town? The business owners, the mayor, the borough council, the school superintendent, the school board, and the school staffs. How can you pray for your the leaders in the buildings in your community? And ask God, Lord, what are you showing us? Speak prophetically over your town as God reveals something to you. I want to challenge you this morning to step up and be a priest and a minister, to stand in the gap for your community. The most important thing, the most important part of all this morning is that Jesus is our great high priest. He's the one who paid the price for each one of us. John 3:16, God loved the world so much that he gave his only son, Jesus, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have eternal life. The most important thing is to know Jesus as our great high priest, as our Lord and Savior. Because Jesus stood in the gap between us and God. And the best part is for you to believe in that, believe in Jesus. And so this morning, as we bow our heads and pray, I'd just like to lead you in a prayer of faith in Jesus. If you've never done that this morning, just invite you to bow your heads. And if you would like to just pray along in your spirit, if you've never committed your life to Jesus this morning, we'd like to help you to do that. There are going to be prayer ministers here to pray with you at the end. But if you'd just like to pray quietly in your heart before God this morning as I lead, the prayer goes something like this. Jesus, I'm sorry for the things I've done wrong in my life. Please forgive me. I now turn from everything I know to be wrong. Thank you that you died on the cross for me so I could be forgiven and set free. Thank you that you offer me forgiveness and the gift of your Spirit. I now receive that gift. Please come into my life by your Spirit to be with me forever. Amen. Would you stand to your feet with me this morning?